So why did I choose Ghana as my first stop in Africa? I'd heard so much about West Africa and where I should possibly go. And one night I decided that I was going to take Google Earth and just kind of scan over West Africa and see what it looked like. And really what I was expecting was to see just a bunch of huts with a bunch of people just kind of out there, you know, half clothed. And to my surprise, when I scanned over Ghana, and in particular Accra, I looked down and I saw these modern buildings. I saw swimming pools, I saw highways, and in that instant, I knew something, I knew that I had not been given the complete picture. And I decided that night that Accra, Ghana was going to be the first place that I visited when I went to Africa. The other thing that was interesting was when I scanned over on Google Earth and I looked at the slave castles. That was really profound because I could see that these slave castles actually existed. I heard about it, I saw it on TV, but when I actually laid my eyes on it, I said, wow, this is some place I need to go first. Honestly, there were a lot of mental hurdles that I had to address when scheduling this trip. The way that I've been trained was to see Africa in a negative light. The other reality is that no one in my immediate family had ever been to Africa, to my knowledge. But I'll never forget a time when there was a gentleman, he said, you owe it to yourself to go to Africa. And he made a really profound statement. He said, you have not lived as a black man in America until you have put your feet on African soil. The reality is I was afraid. The perception that I had in my mind and the mental hurdle that I had to overcome was pretty intense, but I was determined to do it because I needed to see for myself, and I understood that if I did not see for myself, I would be subject to someone else's propaganda or someone else's opinion or interpretation of Africa. And then the other reality is that Africa is not a country. Africa is a continent with more than 50 countries. And so you have the sub-Saharan countries, and then you have the Saharan countries, and then of course you have the Northern African countries. So it's a really large continent. Because we think of Africa as being just, you know, lions and elephants and hippos, there's so much more to it, and that's what I needed to see. Another hurdle that I had to overcome was the fear of getting all of these shots. I was told that if I go to Africa, I'm gonna need to get like 12 shots. I only needed to get one shot to go to Ghana, and that was the yellow fever shot. One shot. Needed to get my passport, needed to get my visa. That's not as difficult as what I thought. The other step was being able to find hotels that were comparable to what I was familiar with here in the States. My tour guide informed me about the cities that we were gonna go to, so I was able to find upscale hotels in all of the cities to keep it familiar, because I didn't know. So I wasn't trying to go someplace and end up sleeping outside somewhere. And so I found very upscale hotels that rival anything here in America. So the day of the departure, I'm excited, I'm nervous. So I go, I check in, and I'm going through the TSA. And as I get on the plane, I'm like, wow, I'm really doing this. This is something that most people that I know, most black men that I know, have not done. How about this? Most people I know have not been to Africa. I said, this is something that is huge because I'm breaking mental barriers, I'm breaking physical barriers. Did not know what I was gonna experience, but I just had a really calm confidence. What I can tell you is that when I arrived and I could look out of the window and I could see African soil, I did feel a sense of accomplishment. In Ghana, they have their own culture. And so as their own culture and their own music, their own vibe, songs we would never even hear in the States. Again, I've been misled. We take the first day to tour. We go to see where W.E.B. Du Bois' museum and where he was buried. We were able to go to the market. And one of the most memorable moments of going to the market was when they took me, they gave me drum lessons. So I'm going through there and doing the drum lessons, but I needed to give them a drum lesson. And a drum lesson straight from the streets of DC, I needed to teach them a go-go beat. So as they were teaching me their beat, I took an attempt at teaching them some DC go-go, trying to get them in the pocket. As you can see, my attempt, it was a nice attempt. We almost got there, because when you think about it, this is what it was supposed to sound like.
All right. Show you that. Thank you so very much. Thank you. Thank you so very, very much, ladies and gentlemen. Now look here. But it don't mean a thing if it don't got the go-go swing.
And that's what it ended up sounding like.
Y'all come on.
But these gifted and talented artists, when you really see them working in that environment, you see how skilled they are as far as making the drums and making the different carvings. It was an experience to see, and everybody was just so chill. It was not like an environment, it was not a hostile environment at all. I mean, I'm still in contact with some of those guys today who were teaching me how to do the African drums. So I still gotta get them right with the whole go-go thing. That's coming though, that's coming. One of the next stops was Abree Gardens, and this was north of Accra. And to go and see some of the trees that you only hear about, you hear about the shea butter tree, you hear about the nutmeg tree, but to actually go and to experience this and touch the leaves and to learn the history and to see the rich resources that are present. One of the most memorable parts at the Abree Gardens was this massive termite mound. And we went over and he knocked off a piece of it and began to explain about the termites, the Africanized termites.
Is this an ant hill?
It's termites.
Termites?
Yeah.
That's you're gonna get them all upset.
These
see?
Are yeah.
Oh, look at that.
So you said if you blew this in there, you see they'll come more.
These are different than the termites in America. I was gonna say these are African termites. I don't think the ones in America eat the star fruit. I think they get that, they eat up houses.
There was so much rich history in the Abree Gardens, There were school children, there were palm trees, there were trees that were gifted by other countries. It was just so much to see. And again, it's one thing to see it on video, it's another thing to see it in person. The next day, we traveled to a city called Kumasi, but there are vendors everywhere. I think everybody in Ghana must be an entrepreneur. I mean, street vendors everywhere you went. I enjoyed seeing that because I learned so much from that and how people survive and how people live. Then they had this massive market, unlike anything that I have ever seen in my life. It was massive, but I loved every minute of walking through and being among the people and just seeing Ghana life. I saw a random peacock in Accra. I saw a random peacock in Kumasi. And so when you just, where are you gonna see a random peacock other than the zoo in America? Just walking around, just minding his business. One of the highlights of my trip was going to the African naming ceremony. And this was outside of Kumasi. And I didn't know what to expect. So I'm going along with it, okay. And so when they saw me, they had a name for me, and so my African name is Twim Barema. Going there and learning more about the Asante tribe and learning more about their culture and their customs, it just, what it did was it dispelled the myths. In the village that I went to, this place produces kente cloth. It also produces cocoa butter. It produces shea butter. It produces black soap. And as I was learning and I was sitting in the cocoa forest, I said, you know what? I'm sitting in the real Wakanda. This is not fiction right here. This is where people are actually, they have enterprise, they have businesses going on, and they have generated an economy for their village, and they know exactly what they're doing.
This is original black soap, and we manufactured them in this village.
Then later on that night, we went to the nightlife and saw people sitting outside and eating and doing just like what we do here in America. The band was outside playing, and I'm out there dancing and having a good time. At one point, I really became upset because it's like somebody had been telling me how I was supposed to think and how I was supposed to view Africa. I saw the rough areas in the villages, and I saw the grass huts. I saw the poverty, but I also saw the upscale side. And so my perspective was like, if you're gonna tell a story, tell the full story. Don't tell a piece of the story. As we were leaving Kumasi, now the trip started taking a very deep perspective, because the reason why I went there was to see some of the slave history. And the first stop to really get to the slave history was a place called Slave River. And some of the things that I learned at Slave River and what the slaves went through, and this was the place where they got their last bath before they were sent off to the slave castles. When going to Slave River, I put my hand down in the water because there's gold embedded in the bedrock. And Ghana is actually formerly known as the Gold Coast because there's so much gold there. And so I put my hand down in this water. This is where slaves, you know, and I believe some of them were my ancestors because some of my DNA came from Ghana, had passed through there. And so putting my hand down in the water and seeing the gold in the bottom, it was just a very profound experience. The highlight of my trip was going to the Elmina Slave Castle. And I realized in that instant that I was a descendant of a multi-European system that had really placed propaganda in, I hesitate to use the word brainwashed because it can be overused, but that's a good word for it, brainwashed, into thinking that where most of my DNA came from, that there was something wrong with that place. And you go, when you go into Elmina Slave Castle, it's heavy. There are no light moments. It's heavy from the moment that you pull up to it. It looks heavy. You walk in and you begin to learn about the history of what took place, what the Portuguese did, what the Dutch did, what the British did, where they all had a piece in this madness. And you learned about the economic impact of slavery and what it really represented. So as you go through this very intense experience, you go into the dungeons. There were some things that they smelled when they were in there. It's almost like you could smell the things that they smelled. The gunpowder. You could see the markings and the carvings on the wall that they left when they were thrown into the dungeons to die. And then the craziest part was that you had churches, like there was a church that they had where they would have church right there in the middle of all of that. And then you have scriptures on the walls, and you're like, what in the world is going on? And when you walk out of there, you're like, wow. When you go up to the governor's mansion, the governor's or the headmaster, his bedroom, and you knew that he was taking these women and raping them. But what made it extra profound for me, and this was another part, another reason why I went over to Ghana, is because I did the ancestry DNA. The ancestry test that really hit me the most was when I did African ancestry. And I recommend anyone who's a descendant of slaves in America to do African ancestry, because what they do that the other ones don't do is take you back to your tribe. So when I did it, I did the maternal and the paternal. And so on my maternal side, all the way back, it went to Sierra Leone, which is not far from Ghana. And then on my father's side, it went back to Portugal, meaning all of the men going back, a Portuguese man at some point started that trail. And then on the mother's side, all the way back to, on the women, a woman from Sierra Leone began my mother's line. But when I was standing there and I looked up and it said Portuguese church, what the slave castle was doing was confirming the history that was being revealed in my DNA. I just sat there and I just kind of thought to myself, I said, this is stuff that you, again, you can watch a documentary, but until you walk through that castle and smell the smells and see the sights and touch the walls, and there's something incomplete. It gave a full context to my life to say, now I get some things. Because my family, we never talked about going to Africa. If anything, we had been so Europeanized that we frowned upon our African roots. And so when I did my ancestry test, it showed that I was 75% African, 25% European. So in realizing that, I owed it to myself to go to the places that showed up in my DNA just to see for myself. So when I walked away from that experience, I didn't want to leave. When I tell you I didn't want to leave, it's not because I resented where I was born. It was because now I wanted to learn more. I wanted to see more. I wanted to experience more and not have it be told to me through the eyes of someone's school system or someone's entertainment. And this is why I encourage American black men to make sure they take this trip. Here's another deep part of it. I was the only American man of African descent that I saw on my entire trip. From Accra to Kumasi to Cape Coast, back to Accra, in the malls, in the markets, everywhere I went, I was the only one that I saw. This is when my mind was blown, because when we were driving up, I saw these beaches. And when I saw the beaches, I was like, wait a minute, I'm still in Africa. And then we pull into the resort. I'm seeing these palm trees and these coconut trees. And I get there and I said, wow, who would have thought that this existed in Africa? Now, people who know it's there, but where I come from, we don't think about Africa being a vacation destination. We don't think about Africa being someplace that you would go and relax and want to stay. And I will tell you, it was so peaceful. And I stayed out on the beach until about 12:30 in the morning. And I just sat there and I said, I don't want to leave. I said, this is something that I'm glad that I've seen. Here's what I recommend, that everyone owes it to themselves to at least step foot on African soil once in their lives. I saw everyone there. I saw Caucasian families there with their children. I saw people from Asia. I saw Lebanese. I saw Indian. I saw Israeli. But I did not see any black men. A lot of sisters. I met a group of sisters. They were out there doing their thing, traveling, enjoying life. But I did not see men who looked like me. And I know that we're the ones who would benefit the most from it. So when I came back with a greater sense of responsibility to teach and to inspire. It's not an expense. It's an investment into your mind. It's an investment into being able to connect some dots, some family dots. It's an investment into you, because it will transform your life. It'll transform the way that you think. It will transform the way that you see Africa. And there are lots of business opportunities there as well. There's tremendous opportunities because it's developing. And because it's developing, this means that there are opportunities for you to get in on the ground level. My next journey is to climb Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania. But I want to go see that side of Africa too, because in that side of Africa, that's where you see the giraffes and the elephants and the lions, and I plan on going on a safari, because some of my DNA comes from that side of Africa as well. I want to go to Zanzibar Island, and I want to learn about the Arab slave trade, because everybody thinks that the Europeans were the only ones who were involved in the slave trade, but the Arabs were doing it as well, and they had dungeons and places where they would take the East Africans. And so I plan on going back to Ghana many times, and I plan on taking people back with me, because I want you to see the sights. I want you to experience the culture. I want you to stay in the hotels. I want you to go to Slave River. I want you to go to the castles, but I also want you to go to the resorts. I want you to taste the food. I want you to be in the environment and see it for yourself. I no longer have a bucket list. I have a do it now list. I encourage you to have a do it now list. So make that investment into your mind and into you. Special touch to it, and when I touch plants, they contract. And I want to show you how effectively I do this. Watch this right here.
Saying in life, there ain't no mountain high enough. Especially, that's been my lifetime saying. Actually, I invented a mountain called Space Mountain. But you, my brother, have climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. Even the Nature Boys have done that. You are my hero. You are my man. You are the man. Congratulations. Woo!
Do you know how I got to the top of Mount Kilimanjaro?
Kissing the rock. It. Yeah, woo!
When I made the decision, I said, I'm going to get to the top of Mount Kilimanjaro.
And that's the reason that you guys all got to listen to him, because he doesn't dream.
Oh,
yeah, he's a doer.
Magical.
It wasn't a matter of, I'm going to ask somebody if it's okay for me to get to the top of Kilimanjaro. The first decision, I said, I'm going to get to the top of this mountain.
I have made it.
You don't understand.
What's taken to get to the roof of Africa, Mount Kilimanjaro.
Oh my goodness.
I said, I'm going to get to the top of Mount Kilimanjaro. And I'm going to prepare myself, and I'm going to do what I need to do in order to get there.
think.
Forward ever, backward never. That's a political slogan of a party before.
Kente is a visual representation of history. They are the powerful cultural symbols and a source of pride, both for Ghanaians and the African diaspora.
Slave dungeon. 110 years was used for slave trade. Those who tried to escape, for those fighting for their freedom. Today, we will call them freedom fighters.
To just really quantify it in a couple of words, but I think the thing that really kind of surrounds my experience is really just the vibrancy of color. I'm a very visual person and that has just grabbed me, and I think the colors for me represent just the vibrancy of spirit that just really talks about the spirit of Ghanaians, and that combined with just the fact that they're so pleasant, they're so warm, they're so open.
I learned a lot. I experienced a lot that I had read about in history, you know, as far as the slave trade and what have you. But to actually be able to set foot where our ancestors actually walked was an emotional journey, high and low. This was a wonderful experience. I'm glad I did it, because I said to myself when I heard about this tour, I said it's either going to be now or never.
Well, it was a great experience here. Just to see another part of the diaspora that we read about, we've seen videos, but to be here in person to experience the rich culture, to see the pride of the natives here in Ghana, was just something to behold. I'm taking away from this a new way of looking at the hustle. These people hustle out here.
Yeah, I would say I share the same sentiments. It's been an experience of a lifetime, being able to come home, and this being the year of return, 400 years after the first recorded forced arrival of Africans And it's just, it's very significant. And to be here and to experience our family, our native family, I should say, and the culture, to walk on this soil, has just been really profound. In addition to being here with new family that we've traveled with, just the entire experience definitely is one to remember. So I just feel grateful.
It's been very enjoyable. I got a chance to enjoy the country. People are wonderful. I saw a lot of folks that look like they're members of my family, and that's serious. I sent a picture with me and the chief that I was standing next to at the naming ceremony, and my cousin responded back that it looks like Timothy, who's another cousin of ours. It was very enjoyable and very enlightening, and I look forward to coming back.
I will be back in a few years. I plan to actually bring my family back because I'm the messenger right now. So out of my generation, I'm the only one out of my family that has been to Africa. So I have to be the messenger for them to let them know that it's safe and that you're gonna be okay.
Ready to land, getting ready to land.
All right, are we ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you're literally in the middle of San Diego. So the lounge is right here. So this is the room.
kindergarten school, but this is a kindergarten for young children. But children, we start here, we start from 3 years up to 7. So you see, it's different years. After 7 years old, we go to primary school. House is four people only.
Okay.
Yes, but my side, you like a big family. But yeah. Big family, not enough only for us inside.
You need a bigger house.
Yes.
So when it rains, you just close that little latch?
Yes, you have a skin from the car, we put the roof.
Huh?
For the herbal medicine. Also, we mix with the other herbal medicine to treat somebody who's been affected with the diabetes. This one is a henna.
Oh, this is henna. Henna,
yeah. We took the leaves, we dried all the sun, after that we make powder. On a skin. To make a local cream.
Mm.
Here, that one we use for the cooking and to cleaning the face.
Lemon tree.
We have big plantation of the coffee here, like Arabica.
Oh, those are raw coffee beans.
Lemongrass.
Lemongrass.
An amazing lunch, an authentic African lunch here at one of the local.
Here they would use every small harbor, they would anchor them from here, you know, their ships, the Arab traders,
okay.
And then take a slave in from there.
and islands, and then shipping them abroad to Zanzibar.
This is very interesting because a lot of people don't get this side of it. They don't know that this door right here is the Arab door of no return. Mainland Zanzibar. This is inside the women's dungeon of the East African slave trade. You can imagine the smell, you can imagine, I mean, just so much in here.
During all the time, the slaves were using this one, everything's here, like toilets, they were finishing, everything's here. So at the same time, they were drawing some salt in that water, so they had no any water.
This was absolutely delicious. Hat, tie, perfect coconut water, coconut, straight from the tree here on Zanzibar Island. You want to make sure that you visit and experience this for yourself. All the different spices, the different cultures, the different histories, all of this is right here on this beautiful island in paradise.
Language called Ghiz means first, and this is the only language in Africa except Copt. This is the only language in Africa written, documented. We call it Ghiz. We do believe it's the first language. So this is our number and calendar.
And this was built in 1632.
Yeah, 1632. This is where they were hanging meat. Have you seen Ethiopians are experiencing raw meat? Raw meat?
They eat raw meat?
Yeah, raw meat too.
This man was called Johannes Sadiku because he freed the people from taxation. First row of the window, 1, 2, 3, was the symbolic of the three Trinity. And then the other one is that from top to bottom. The upper one is that the symbolic of Jesus.
Honey wine.